since we didn't have class last time, let me recall quickly what we were looking at is the so-called natural embedding. Of a nonlinear space into its second dual. Okay, so this is what we were looking at. How do we define this? So we take a nonlinear space and define a map eta from that to the second dual. And this is what we called as the, and how is eta defined as? Eta must take any vector in this nonlinear space into its double dual, which will denote by f, of course it will depend on x, fx. And what should fx do? Fx must be in x double star. So where fx is in x double star means it must be a functional on x star. So fx action on any f is f of x for every f in x. So that's the definition of the natural embedding. Okay, and this is what we were looking at. So what we were looking at was how good is this identification of the vectors in x with the double dual. So we have this x here and we have the x double star, and any x, the eta is a map here, and any x here is taken into the eta x, which is fx. This is the identification that we have. Now, what we had observed was, we had seen, one, eta is linear. That is, it preserves the vector space structure. Additions are preserved and linear scalar multiplications are preserved. So, superpositions are preserved. That is what is meant by saying it is linear. So, it preserves the vector space structure. And but this has more than vector space structure. They have the non-linear space structure. So the next question was whether it preserves the norms, and then we further had the following two properties. Eta preserves, is non-preserving. That is, if you take x and fx, both have the same norm. X as the norm here, fx as the norm in x double star, and the two norms are equal. It is non-preserving, and the identification is good in the sense it is 1-1. That is, different elements are identified with different elements there, provided these two properties, provided we had this following lemma. It was crucial. We assumed this lemma and proved that these two properties come about. What was the lemma? That given any x in the nonlinear space, x non-zero, so given any non-zero vector in that space, there exists a bounded linear functional such that, one, it precisely takes the value, I will call it x naught, okay, f of x naught, the norm value at the point x naught, and as a linear functional, it has a norm 1. This was a crucial lemma. That is, given any element here, there is a linear functional which precisely filters out the norm for that particular vector. Any linear functional filters out a number for every vector. This particular linear functional filters out that number which is precisely the norm of the vector. Okay, that is the filter, and it is works within the norm 1. So I will call this also f naught because it depends on the x naught. So I will call it as f naught. So given any vector, there is a functional which precisely filters out the norm of the functional, and we can make that linear functional to have norm 1. Okay, this is the crucial lemma. Okay, and as I said, this is the essence of the Hahn-Banach theorem. But before I go into the Hahn-Banach theorem, let us look at some examples of this explicitly, concrete examples of this sort of f naughts. Okay, so let us look at some examples, very simple examples to illustrate of functionals of this type of functionals. Okay, that means this what is in the lemma, that type of functional. Okay, so let us look at example 1. Let me call it as example. Okay, in that example itself there will be several one or two examples within the example. First of all, let us take R3. Take the simplest case, the three dimensional space which we are familiar with. Take R3, then we are going to take a fixed vector in that. So let x naught be some vector, say 1 1 0, that I have not yet given the norm. So the various examples that come out are got by taking different norms on R3, but the vector is going to be the same, x naught. Okay, now consider A. Let us first consider the example. Consider the 2 norm. So consider this as a vector in this, okay, the 2 norm. So what is norm x naught? Now in this space, square root of 2, 1 plus 1, which is square root of 2. So now what this theorem says, this lemma says, is there must be a linear functional such that f naught at this vector is root 2 and the norm of the functional is 1. So the lemma says, there exists f naught belonging to L 2 3 R star, because that is our norm XL now, such that 1 f naught x naught is equal to square root of 2, the norm of the vector, and norm of f naught is equal to 1. That is what that lemma says. Now, let us look at what this f naught is. So, let us get such an f naught. Now, where should f naught be? We want f naught in L 2 3 R star. Okay, but we had seen that L 2 star is isomorphic to L 2 itself. That is, given any linear functional, there is a corresponding vector which generates the linear functional. So we have seen that for corresponding to any f in L 3 2 R star, in fact we looked at for L n R star, in particular I am looking at L 3 2 R, there exists a vector f in L 3 2 R such that 1 the action of f can be obtained as f1 x1 plus f2 x2 plus f3 x3 and the norm of the functional is the same as the norm of the vector in that space, which is square root of f1 square plus f2 square plus f3 square. This we know from our analysis of the dual space. We have seen a number of examples and we found that the dual space of L2 is itself, that means every functional can be identified with a vector in that, which generates that. Okay, so therefore, there must be a corresponding vector for the functional that we are looking for. For every f in that L3 star, there is such a little f. So, particularly for the f0 that we are looking for, there must be a corresponding f0. So, corresponding to the f0 that we are looking for, there must be an f, call it f0, equal to f1 0 or f0 1 or whatever way you want, f3 0, such that these two now translate for the f0, such that f0 x is equal to f1 0 x1 plus f2 0 x2 plus f3 0 x3. Okay, it's not f10 x1 plus f20 x2 or something like that, but f4 if you want comma, doesn't matter, it's clear. And norm of f0 must be equal to square root of f1 0 squared plus f2 0 squared plus f3 0 squared. There must be such an f0. So the problem of finding the f0, capital f0, is the same as finding the problem of finding the little f0. So actually we are looking for the little f0. Okay, but we want, let's look at what we want. We want these two, which you must choose our capital f0, so that f0 filters the norm of x0 for x0 and its norm is 1. So by star we need f0 x0 must be root 2. What is f0 x0? f1 0 into x1, x1 is 1, plus f2 0 into x2 which is 1, plus f3 0 into x3 which is 0. That must be equal to root 2, let me call it as 1, and norm of f0 must be equal to 1, but norm of f0 is this, so it must be square root of f1 0 squared plus f2 0 squared plus f3 0 squared must be equal to 1. So now I know how to choose f1 0 f2 0 f3 0. I have to choose them such that these two happen. The moment I choose f1 0 f2 0 f3 0, such that these two happen, then I will define the vector f0, I will define f0 to be this, and I will get what I want. Okay. So therefore, the problem of finding the f0 boils down to finding f0 f1 0 f2 0 f3 0 satisfying 1 and 2. So let's see how to find that. So let's look at 1. One says f2 naught must be chosen as square root of 2 minus f1 naught. Okay, that's the simple one. Now, therefore, 2 implies I will square both sides. Okay, the square root is 1, the square is also 1. F1 naught squared plus f2 naught squared. For f2 now I should substitute this, plus f3 naught squared must be equal to 1. Right? Now let us expand, and I will do a few things. F1 naught squared, if you square this, it is 2 plus f1 naught squared minus 2 root 2 f1 naught plus f3 naught squared is equal to 1. Just square both sides. Now what I will do is, there is an f1 naught squared here, there is an f1 naught squared here. That will make it 2 f1 naught squared. There is a 2, there is a 2. So everything has a 2. So I will factor out that f1 naught squared minus 2 root 2 f1 naught plus 1 plus f3 naught squared is equal to 1. Okay. Or I will divide by 2 and I can write this as half. Okay. Now I will do a final trick, let us forget about it. Now complete the square. Whenever you have a square and that, you always do the completion of the square. So what should I do? It will be f1 naught minus, I should write it as 2 times something into f0, which is 2 into 1 by root 2 into f0. So it is f0 minus 1 by root 2 squared. What will that give? F1 naught squared plus minus 2 by root 2 f0, which is this. It will also give a plus 1 by 2. So I have taken 1 by 2 here out of the 1, another half will be there. Right, plus f3 naught squared by 2 is equal to half. See, actually in the beginning these are the computations one does. Finally, one gets Hahn-Banach theorem. Okay, it didn't come from heavens. Right, this you do calculations in finite dimensional space. Then the half gets cancelled, and therefore finally you get f1 naught minus 1 by root 2 whole squared plus f3 naught squared must be equal to 0. But the sum of squares is 0 if and only if each term is 0. So f1 naught must be 1 by root 2, f3 naught must be 0. Now you substitute there, f2 naught will be root 2 minus 1 by root 2, which we take common denominator root 2, so again that becomes root 2. Therefore, that gives f2 naught is also 1 by root 2. So now we have a complete choice, completely fixed. F1 naught has to be 1 by root 2, f2 naught has to be 1 by root 2, and f3 has to be 0. Okay, so therefore, we have f naught is equal to 1 by root 2, 1 by root 2 0, and f defined as f of f naught of x is 1 by root 2 x1 plus 1 by root 2 x2 plus 0 times x3 for every x. And this satisfies all these conditions. This is the required f. So therefore, we have a unique f naught satisfying star. Okay, in this case we were able to find precisely one f naught. There is only one linear functional which filters the norm x naught value at the point x naught. There is one unique filter for this vector x naught. Okay. Let us change this problem. Instead of same vector, but we will change the norm. Okay. So now B, same vector, But let us now consider L1R. What is now the norm? What is L1 norm? Sum of the components absolute value. So it is 1 plus 1, 2. Okay. So now what does the lemma says? There exists, now instead of L2, I have L13R star, such that F naught X naught is 2 and norm F naught is equal to 1. This is what the lemma says. Okay. Now the norms have changed. So therefore, I have to filter the new norm. Okay. The previous filter was the L2 norm filter. Now we want to look for an L1 norm filter. Okay. That's what we are looking for. When we look for L2 norm filter, we got a unique filter. Now we will see that when we are looking for L1 norm filter, we will be having several such possible filters. Okay. Again, we will go through the same argument. I will just therefore want F naught now where? L1 3R star. Now again we saw that corresponding to this statement we have L infinity. The L1 star was L infinity in finite dimension, in any space, okay, even in infinite thing it is true. Okay. And this is true, but now what is this? Norm F infinity. What is norm F infinity? Maximum of mod F1, mod F2, mod F3. So, I'll therefore, again, probably I should write these things carefully, okay, so that I don't make a mess. So, therefore, we are looking for an F0 in L1 star, but L1 star is identified with L infinity. And therefore, with every such functional, there must be a vector of this type with the norms coinciding with the infinite norm. And therefore, corresponding to, see, arguments are going on parallel as before. Corresponding to the F naught we are seeking, there must be an F naught equal to F1 naught, F2 naught, F3 naught, such that again F naught X is equal to F1 naught X1 plus F2 naught X2 plus F3 naught X3 to norm F naught is equal to norm F naught infinity, which is equal to maximum of mod F1 naught, mod F2 naught, mod F3 naught. Okay? So that's what we are looking for. So we are again, the problem of finding capital F naught is reduced to the problem of finding little F naught. Now, what are the conditions little F naught should satisfy? Previously, we used the star. Again, by star, now we need F naught X naught. What is that equal to? F1 naught plus F2 naught. What should that be equal to now? That should now be equal to 2. And I call this as 1, norm F naught, which should be the F infinity norm, which is equal to the maximum of mod F naught to F1 naught, mod F2 naught, mod F3 naught, that must be equal to now 1. Let us call this as 2. So the conditions that we are demanding, that the norm of X naught be filtered, boils down to this, and the filter as norm 1 boils down to this, right? Now therefore, the problem of finding F naught, capital F naught, boils down to finding the little f naught satisfying 1 and 2. So let me write. Therefore, problem of finding f naught satisfying star reduces to finding f naught satisfying 1 and 2. Now, as before, we will use 1 and 2 and see what is going to be our f1 naught and f2 naught. Okay, so what does 1 imply? F1 naught plus f2 naught equal to 2, and 2 implies the maximum of mod f1 naught, mod f2 naught, mod f3 naught must be equal to 1. What can you conclude from these two? F1 naught and f2 naught have to be 1. If they try to waver anywhere else, they are in trouble. Okay. If they go outside 1, this will be violated. If they stay between minus 1 and 1, anything smaller, this will not be satisfied. So they are both have to be 1. So these two together imply f1 naught equal to f2 naught equal to 1. 2/3 of our problem is over. Our problem is that of finding little f naught. Little f naught has 3 coordinates. We already found 2. So the only it remains to find, it remains to find f3 naught. Okay. Whatever it is, so let f3 naught be alpha. Instead of writing f3 naught, we will write f3 naught be alpha. So we have to find alpha. Okay. So now let us look at fx, f naught x must be equal to, where is that, f1 naught x1, but f1 naught is what, 1, plus f2 naught x2, but f2 naught is 1, plus x2, plus f3 naught, which I called as alpha, x. This is true for any x. For any x, f naught x must have this form. And therefore, okay, I will not even do all this. I will make a much simpler analysis. Okay. So, what is norm f naught? It is now maximum of mod f naught, mod f2 naught and mod alpha, because this f1 naught we have found it to be 1, f2 naught we have found it to be 1, this we called as alpha and this we want it to be 1. Therefore, what does it say about alpha? Mod alpha must be less than or equal to 1. So, that implies mod alpha less than or equal to 1. So, therefore, you can choose any alpha. As long as mod alpha is less than or equal to 1, we are done. So, choose any alpha real number such that mod alpha less than or equal to 1 and define f naught x as x1 plus x2 plus alpha x3, then f naught satisfies star. So now we have got infinite number of filters which do the job for us. The previous case, the same vector with the L2 norm, we were able to get only one filter, but with the L1 norm, we are able to get infinite number of filters. So we have infinite choices here. So, there is a tremendous amount of variation But the fact of the matter is that there is one. We are guaranteed one F naught always, which filters out the naught. For any given vector, there corresponds a filter which filters out the naught. And the filter has not bond. Okay, it works within this. This is what the lemma says. Okay, this is the the meaning of the lemma. Whatever be the norm, whatever be the non-linear space, whatever non-zero vector you choose, there will be always a filter which filters that norm, and that filter can be made to have norm bond. That's the beauty of this lemma. Okay, so we have seen two concrete examples where this can be done. Obviously, these concrete examples can be changed to, instead of R3, instead of L3 to R, I could have taken L to R, infinite sequence. And similarly, instead of L1R, I could have chosen L13R, I could have chosen L1R, infinite sequence. Same argument will work through. And there you will find, when you go to L1, there is infinite number of choices. X3 can be chosen, that alpha coefficient can be chosen arbitrarily. The fourth coefficient can be chosen arbitrarily. Fifth coefficient can be chosen arbitrarily. So, we will have a phenomenal amount of choice when you go to L1R. Okay. So, this is the two simple examples of what this lemma means. Okay. Here, we have actually explicitly computed what this F0 is. It is not always possible to calculate this F0 explicitly, but whenever it is possible to calculate explicitly, if you do that, there is a lot of insight in the problem that you get. Okay. Are these two examples clear? Yeah. Okay. So therefore, now we go back to the lemma. Now we are being little bit assured by these examples that is a reasonable question to ask. In many cases, we are able to do it. In the standard examples that we have seen, we are able to do it. So, we will go back to the lemma. So, let me again restate the lemma. Given x naught in the norm linear space, x naught non-zero, there exists a filter such that it filters out the norm for this vector, and two, the filter itself has norm 1. This is what the lemma says. Now let's push towards proving that lemma. Okay. So let us say, how can we go about getting such an F0? That's the question. Okay. So what we are looking for a F0, right? The only thing that we know is we want this F0 x0 to be normal. That is, we know the value of the functional where just at one vector, that is given, and we are also given that this F0 should operate within the constraint that its elastic limit is 1. Okay. Within that elastic limit of 1, it should operate. So, therefore, if at all I want to define the functional, I must tell what does it do at all points. All I know is its value at 1 point. It's a sort of a terrible job. You have an infinite space, infinite number of vectors are sitting there, and you say the value here is this, tell me what is the value at other places. Okay. All I want is you do it whatever you want. I want this value at this point and I this elastic limit for that function. These are the two constraints. Within that constraint, you work and get me that F0. Okay. So now what we will do is, okay, from the given information, what is the best we can do to start with? Okay, so we are given the value of F naught at one point x naught. That's all. We are starting with that. Okay. Now let me call W naught as all those vectors which are generated by x naught, the one dimensional space generated by x naught. Take this x naught as a basis and take all the vectors which are generated by this x naught. They will be vectors of the form k times x naught or alpha times x naught. That is what is known as the manifold generated by x naught. So let us call W naught to be the linear manifold generated by x naught, which is the set of all vectors x in x such that x is equal to alpha x naught, where alpha belongs to R. Let us look at this manifold. Then we will see first of all what are the value, what should be the values for F naught for vectors in this space. Okay. So for any x is equal to alpha x naught belonging to L x naught, we have want to find out what it is. F naught x must be equal to F naught alpha x naught, but we want F naught to be linear. So it has to be alpha times F naught x naught must be equal to alpha times F naught x naught, because want F naught linear, but we also want F naught x naught to be norm x naught. That the value at this point is known. So immediately I substitute this. So therefore we know this F naught has to be this for all these vectors along this line. Hence we know how to define F naught on W naught. Therefore, the problem boils down to, I give you a linear functional, bounded linear functional on a subspace. How do you push it all the way up? And this fellow's norm is 1, we will calculate this fellow's norm. And in the smaller space, we want to maintain that same norm outside. See, note, norm F naught so far. So let me call it as W naught, only on the W naught star part of it. That is mod F naught x by norm x, supremum x belongs to W naught x naught equal to 0. That we'll call, this is actually equal to 1, that we can is actually calculate. So that's equal to 1. So what we are looking for is, we were given the bounded linear functional small part and the elastic limit in that small part. We want to extend it all over the place such that the same elastic limit is maintained, and in this part it is the same. So the problem therefore is, hence we can rephrase our lemma as follows. Given a subspace W naught of a nonlinear space, we are given a subspace and a linear functional only on that subspace. Okay, only on that subspace the linear functional is given and it is bounded, then can we find a linear functional on the whole space such that it is an extension of this f naught w naught is equal to little f naught w naught for every w naught in w naught, so that it doesn't alter what we know but now gives new information outside. And if you look at the norm of f naught on the whole x star space, it is the same as the norm of f naught as an element of, so it is non-preserving extension. This is what is known as non-preserving extension. A linear functional is extended as a linear functional, bounded linear functional is extended as a bounded linear functional, bounded linear functional is extended as a bounded linear functional with the same norm as the original smaller part. Okay, so this is what Hahnbach, that the answer is yes, is what is Hahnbach theorem. The Hahnbach theorem says that this can be done. Okay, pardon me, W naught star means see, you have this space X. Okay, inside this is this W naught, right? Now this W naught itself can be thought of as a nonlinear space. That norm restricted to this, that makes it as a nonlinear space. The moment you have a nonlinear space, you have its dual. That is what is known as W naught star. Okay, and therefore the supremum of the ratio is calculated only with respect to vectors in that W naught space. Okay, so therefore the answer, that finally the answer to this is yes, is what is known as Hahnbach theorem. Okay, so now we will state this as the theorem. So this lemma is a consequence of a more general statement called the Hahnbach theorem. Banach was a Polish mathematician and apparently very read that once Hilbert heard Banach talking to somebody and made a remark that this guy is going to do some very good work. Okay, he talks something very sensible and very deep, and finally he did. It's a central theorem in functional analysis. Okay, okay, so let me state that theorem. Let x, it has several consequences. Okay, in analysis, let x be a nonlinear space and w naught a subspace. Let me precisely write, let f naught map w naught to, let me take a very special case first, take the field to be real number. So let us call this as the real Hahnbach theorem. Okay, we'll write the complex Hahnbach theorem as a consequence of this. Okay, if we put two real things together, you get complex. Okay, the real part and the imaginary part. Anyway, we'll look at the real part first. So we have a subspace, and we have, this is what I meant, a functional defined only for vectors in W naught, that is, and f naught belongs to w naught star. I will call it as W naught star norm. Okay. What does this mean? Let me just write it aside. What this means is, if you now took the values of F naught for every element there and divided by the norm, and then took the supremum over all the vectors in W naught, W naught not equal to theta, that is what is called as the norm of F naught W naught star. Okay, this is, it's like treating this as a non-linear space and treating this as a bounded space, linear functional on that non-linear space. So instead of all of X, we have given information in a smaller portion of X, which is itself a non-linear space. Treat that smaller portion as a non-linear space and work with the norm there. Then this is the hypothesis. Every theorem, in fact, I had a friend when I joined this institute way back. His first advice was, you must first make all our students realize that a theorem has two parts. The first part is called the hypothesis, and the second part is the conclusion that you can make from that hypothesis. I asked him, why do you say that? Is it not obvious? And then he showed me some 3 or 4 answer scripts for his test. He says, this is a confusion among the students about this. So you must always write the theorem very carefully. So this is the hypothesis. Then the conclusion is, there exists a linear functional which is defined on the whole space such that, one, that is why it is called extension theorem. One, F naught of W naught is equal to little f naught of W naught for every W naught in WR. So this capital F naught and little f naught coincide in the portion where F naught is defined. Okay, but capital F naught is defined all over the place, whereas little f naught is defined only on the smaller subspace. And if you calculate the capital F naught norm, what is that? That is now supremum of capital F naught x divided by norm x, now where x varies over the whole space. That will be equal to what the norm you started with. Whatever was the elastic limit in the smaller portion, the same elastic limit is maintained in the bigger portion also. So this is norm preserving extension of the linear functional little f naught. It preserves the norm, it is an extension. Such norm preserving extensions are possible, is what Hahn-Banach theorem states. Okay. It does not say that it is unique. It only assures you that there is such an extension. We saw in the example, in the case of L2-3R, the extension was unique. There was only one filter available. But in the case of L3-1R, the extension was not unique. Of course, the question is, under what conditions is it unique, under what condition it is not unique. Again, there is this question, the business of reflexivity of the space comes into the picture. If the natural embedding is onto, then the extension, the space is reflexive, and then it will be unique also. Okay. But we will not get into those questions at the moment at least. Okay. So that is what Hahn-Banach theorem is. So therefore, instead of proving the lemma, it's enough if you prove the Hahn-Banach theorem. Then the lemma was restated as a special case of this. In the lemma case, that one subspace W naught was the one-dimensional subspace, that's all. Okay. So therefore, it is a special case of Hahn-Banach theorem. So the question therefore is, how does one go about proving it? Yeah? This one? You didn't understand? Oh, this is W, okay, this is W naught star. You are right. Absolutely right. That norm. Okay? Now I am going to look at this proof very carefully. Okay, this is a very important argument in analysis, which for the first time problem you see in great detail. Okay, so what is the situation? Let me make it again a pictorially very clear. Here is x, here is w naught, and here is r, and what all we know is that, right? F naught mapping w naught to r, which is linear, bounded, etc., etc. We are trying to construct, then we want suddenly all the remaining places also F naught. So we want this. That's what we want. Okay. So there is a, we don't know how to do it, right? Yet. There is a very famous statement by Polya, a very famous mathematician. Have you heard of Polya? Everybody must have heard of Polya, a very fantastic teacher he was. The way he would explain things was there was once a lecture I attended on topology. There was a speaker who was talking on a very complex subject called knot theory. It is not NOT knot, the KNOT knot, okay, the knot theory. And this guy wrote a lot of groups and transformations and etc., etc., to explain certain knots. Okay. Then Polya got up and twisted his hands, and this is what you mean. Everybody understood what he meant. Okay. So the knot is geometrically produced by a very complicated twist of his arms and other things, and said, this is exactly what you mean. Okay. With all those equations, he could avoid it with one explanation of a picture which demonstrated the simple version of the knot. Okay. What Polya meant there was, when you have not solved a problem, you are stuck. Remember, there must be a simpler version of the problem which you have still not solved. If you had solved that simpler version, you would have understood what is to be done. So see what you can do in the simple cases that will give you a lead into what you should do in the complex cases. So what do you mean by simple cases? Now, on the one hand, we have in this small piece, in the lemma, in a one-dimensional space, but whole space may be infinite-dimensional. We want to go immediately jump to the other extreme. No, don't do it. Can you do a smaller extension first? First of all, are you able to extend at all? Leave alone extending to the whole space. Can you make one step up? What do you mean by one step up? Can you extend that one more dimension? I will get a W1 space which encloses W0 and has dimension one more than W0, and can I now extend it to that bigger portion? Okay. I am not even asking extending to the whole space, just make one step, move, get out of your constraint, restriction of being within W0 and try to move out. Okay. And this is what the famous statement of Armstrong, one small step for man and one big leap for mankind. Okay. So that's what Banach did, one small step he did and one big leap theorem. Okay. So the question that a simpler problem. Okay. Given, suppose if W1 is a subspace of X such that W1 contains W0 and not equal to, okay, strictly contains, and the dimension of W1 is one more than the dimension of W naught. What exactly do we mean by that? I will take a basis, I will take one vector outside, okay, and then take the space spanned by this and this together, okay, that will give me one dimension what. How do I write the space spanned by that and that together? Any vector in the space spanned by W naught and x together can be written as a combination of a vector in W naught plus a multiple of x. That is what is known as the sum. Okay, so such that W1, I will now define W1 like this, such that W1 is equal to the set of all vectors in x such that it is of the form W0 plus alpha x. Where W naught belongs to W naught and alpha belongs to R. So let x belong to x minus W naught and W1 be the subspace span like this. Okay. Let us consider a subspace which is just one dimension more than W naught. Okay, one dimension more means it must be one more linearly independent vector must be coming from outside. So any vector in that dimension it is. So this is what the space we are looking at. So we are taking a vector outside and we are now looking at the subspace spanned by all of them together that will obviously encompass W naught. So this is what we are looking at. Let this be says. Now can we find an F naught belonging to W1 star? That is, it should be a linear functional on the expanded part such that one, it is an extension F naught of W naught is equal to F naught of W naught for every W naught and W. So we have not lost any old information. The old information is retained, it is extension, and the elasticity is not lost. And if you look at the norm of F naught hat, why do I call it F naught hat? I will call it F1. Okay, so that's simplification. The F1 as a W1 star is the same as the norm of F naught as an element of W naught star. Okay, so what does in simple language it means? Can I have a non-preserving extension to one dimension more? Can I have a non-preserving extension to one dimension more? Okay, now I am just indicating how the proof will go. We will see the proof later. Suppose yes. Suppose we are able to achieve that. Okay. What will be the next step? I can extend to two dimension more. Then by induction I can go on doing. But then how many dimensions I would have added? To the dimension of W naught, I would have added only a countable number of dimensions. But what is the guarantee that there is no uncountable number of dimensions still left? Okay. So at best you can proceed by this induction only a countable number of dimensions more. So when you want to move from countable to uncountable, you should alter your induction. So instead of the forward classical mathematical induction, we must know what is known as transfinite induction. And that a useful way of stating that is the so-called Zond's lemma, which we saw in the earlier summer part of it. So Zond's lemma will then give you, suppose yes, then Zond's lemma will then give you maximal possible extension. We will explain all these terms in detail. That is, what is the largest extension you can make? And we have to finally assert that the maximal completely covers the whole space. Okay. So the next step will be the maximal is indeed, maximal extension is indeed what we want, is indeed extension to whole space. Okay. So basically we have put nothing in this. If you know how to move out, you know how to move out completely. If you know how to move out one step, then John's lemma says you can move out to the maximum possible distance, and finally you find the maximum possible is the whole space. Because if it were not, there would have been one more extension possible and the maximality would have been lost. So once you have this, the rest of the ball game is trivial. Okay, more or less a standard procedure in mathematical induction and maximality ideas. So therefore, the crux of the proof is how to go one dimension more. That's all. From the given subspace, can we make one dimension more extension with norm preserving? If we can achieve it, you are done. Okay. And we will see in the next class how we should do this. See, now I know that if I have to go one dimension up, at least I know how to get started. I have to define it on these vectors. But since it is linear, I have to define it on this and on this. I know how to define it on this because it should be extension. So I have to tell only how to define it on x. Okay. So that definition must be so done so that this norm is preserved, and we'll see how to do it. That's all. So now we know exactly what to do. So, okay, so the theorem looked very big. We brought it down to a simpler. That's what Paul asked. Clever idea. I mean, the thought is always in a mathematical problem, there is a very simple version. You look at it, it will tell you then from then on how to move forward. Okay, because we wanted to go out all the way. We didn't even know how to get out of this place. If you first find out how to get out of this place, that's enough for me. I will tell you how to get out all the way out. Okay. And that's what induction, transfinite induction is. So what I'll do is, next time I will tell you formally how to do this, this particular step of going up to one dimension, and then how to use Zorn's lemma, and then how to conclude we have got the extension we want. Okay. So next class will be proof of Hahn-Banach theorem. Right, I think it's time to stop.